We'll call the meeting to order, and I'm sorry, I don't think I have minutes, but you know what we've been doing. And we're at the point now where we need to talk about our meetings that we had with Chris Close, the consultant from the Maine Preservation Committee. So I will start with a few things that have happened that I need to have you know about. Chris, I sent you all his report, and I also have some here in case you don't have the other one with you. But one thing that he recommended is that we look into joining the Maine Downtown Center. He recommended looking at that website, and I called Ann Ball, the interim director, and she would very much like to have us. It isn't only our small committee that would be a part of that. We would need to join with, for example, the Revitalization Committee, the HUP, something like that,
HABA.
The downtown
yeah,
group. And I think they're all willing to do it. However, it costs money. And so Ann said she was going to, the director who I spoke with said that she will look into whether she can find money elsewhere or whether she can modify that. And I haven't been able to reach her since then. So I will keep after that and keep be sure that you know about what's going on there. But I think, you know, they have workshops, they have, they send out informational material. I think it would be to our benefit, to all of us in the community who does this kind of thing.
Where are they located?
They're located in, this is Augusta.
Augusta,
yeah. They had their meeting up in Ellsworth the last time, but I think their office is in Augusta. I attended what do we have down here next? The Main Street Revitalization Committee meeting last night. And I brought you the agenda for that meeting. I frankly couldn't hear a lot of it because they spoke conversationally, and I was down at that end, and I just didn't pick up everything that they said. But generally, and Lynn was there, so Lynn, you can help me. I think generally they were talking about where they are on better improving the sidewalks, the lights, and drainage from the roofs and all of that kind of thing. One thing I thought was very interesting is that they're willing to replace the stoops along the stores to make them granite steps, which I think would be a really good idea. So, what else did you get out of
that? Well, the building, to add to that, the homeowners had to pick that up if they wanted to.
Oh, is that right? See, I missed that.
Yeah.
Was there a price mentioned?
No, it depends on... they talk about using the granite that they take out along the sides of the road.
Yeah.
Some of it is older than others, of different quality. But we'll have that as kind of a stockpile. They'll put all new in so it'll all match. And some of that they can use for stoops at that time. But it's at the owner's expense, as well as maybe other things.
Well, it shouldn't cost too much to buy a piece of stone then.
I think the stone would be free, you know.
Oh, the stone would be free. It would be the installation?
Yes, yeah. Or anything else that they wanted to do, if they wanted to improve their stoop, it would be a good time to do it.
Okay, well, I sit in on that just as an onlooker, just to keep informed, and so therefore I will obviously keep you informed. That would be the reason for my going.
Any of us can come if we want to.
Oh, yeah.
It's a public meeting.
Meetings are open meetings. It's just that I want to keep up with what's going on. I guess nothing really is because they keep saying that this hasn't been decided yet, et cetera, et cetera. So it's going to go on and on.
This is the fall. They were going to have another meeting that would be more like the first one they had about the street, the curves, and crosswalks, and they're still in the talking about what we, our input of what we would like to see. And then the revitalization is kind of covers what the town's responsibility for putting. I mean, they're going to change the dig everything up and change the road, but we have the responsibility as a town of what kind of sidewalks they would put in for tar, or that amount, and if we want brick or something else, and or lighting or special lighting, the town has to pick that up. So we have a definite interest as his being historic preservation of what they do with where they move the road, what they how close they get to buildings. I think is one thing to keep in mind with them, and but also the, you know, the new lanterns and things like that.
The actual start is 2018, isn't it?
Sorry? Yes.
2018 is the actual start.
Yes, spring.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
That's what I understand.
Yes.
Yeah. I am a member of the Main Street Committee. I just couldn't get there last night. I had a commitment that I had to keep.
There's a lot of things going on.
So I'll be getting minutes
okay,
of that. And if there's anything there, I'll let you know.
There wasn't much there I didn't think that applied to us last night, particularly, except maybe the sidewalks and the lanterns.
No, I don't think it does. I think that we just want to be sure we know what's going on.
Yes.
So that if anything does come
yes.
up, that we can
yes. That's good.
Have input. Mm-hmm. That's what we wanted, the committee wanted, was input from this group and the Historical Society,
yeah,
anybody that has an interest in the historic outlook of the town.
No, I completely agree, and it's it, because in a blink of an eye, it'll be a decision will be made, and
right.
it'll be too late. If you want to make changes.
There was a oh, that was with Chris Close. I was going to bring up something else, but I think I'm mistaken. I think I told you last time about our communication from a man who says he's a descendant of Sam Houston.
Oh, yeah.
And I told you what I wrote back to him, that we'd be willing to work with any help him in any way we could. He apparently doesn't have too many records or have any, I think he, from what he said, he doesn't really have any records either. So it's going to be interesting to see how that works out. And I haven't heard from him since the last time I answered him.
Excuse me, Marie, should Charlene and he get together?
He said he had talked, even when I talked with him, he had said he had talked with Charlene. But then when I told Charlene about our communication from him, she didn't seem to remember. But anyway, she knows now because I told her. And I recommended to him that he get her book, which had, I think, everything that she knows about it in that book that she wrote. So we'll see what happens. I wanted to tell you that we're working with, the town is working with Jay Black, the printer down just on this side of the bridge. They're really nice people to work with, a young couple. They're doing the work on revising the brochure, changing the site of the building. Remember, we had the wrong building for a particular site. And that's been corrected now, not only on the big map, but on the small brochure. And I think the placards are up. I see them around,
yes.
So I presume that they're
them.
All up.
When will these brochures be ready?
Well, that's the next thing I'm going to tell you. They have the digital material all ready to go down at Black. And so I told James, and he said he'll go down. And I think he wants to discuss cost with them, because previously they had been printed Snow's, a company I think called Snow, which did a good job, but I said it would be awfully nice if we could have somebody local. And he agreed, so I think it's going to depend upon what the price is. So we'll just have to keep after him to get down, because we do need new brochures, because that one correction has to, you know, is misleading. Oh, well, the other thing I wanted to mention about that is that when I was talking with her, she said, you know, that the Maine State library has received some funds to digitize history of local towns. And she said, why don't you see whether they want to acquire the materials that we have? So I'm now in the process of trying to, you know, these things always take so much time, getting in touch. I did get in touch with the main librarian, but she referred me to another person who has charge of this. And I have not been able to reach him. But I will keep trying, and as I understand it, we would let him copy the digital materials that we have and retain them ourselves, because it's good that we did that, because we needed that to make up the new brochures. So I will keep you apprised of how that goes, and I feel certain that they will want this.
Is that just the museum in the street?
Well, I'll talk to her about that. I mentioned the museum in the street, and she says, oh yes, the head librarian said, oh yes, I know about that, and we would like that. So I don't know, what else do you have in mind, Karen?
I don't know, I wonder what else we have digitized. Do we have anything else that's like maps and...
The museum does.
It's all digitized.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they could
attach
to any
of
it.
The museum has the maps that are digitized. We sent them up to Bangor, the big maps. The old maps, we have those all digitized. And they're at the museum. And they're probably on disk over there already. Oh yeah, they are. So contact Cipolli and...
When you say the big maps, which big
maps? The old
maps,
like the 1875 and
okay.
All those old maps. I think we did a half a dozen or something like that. And they're all digitized.
All right, well I'll ask him whether he would be wanting to get in touch with Cipolli.
Mm-hmm.
Good idea. Okay, next I have a meeting with Chris Close. I thought he was very helpful.
Oh, I thought he was wonderful, yeah.
And I sent you his report. Now, do you all have that with you?
I don't.
I happen to.
What's it look like? I have
right.
A bunch of stuff. I just want
yeah.
To know what
well, that's the thing I have on my
yeah.
On my laptop thing or my iPad.
Yeah, I didn't send you the print. I sent you the website.
The attachment.
I forwarded the email.
Okay. That's what I have is the email. Do you need one?
Yeah, I'll take another one.
I forwarded it to you. I've forwarded everybody on the list.
Yeah, I have it. But I don't have it with me.
So.
Oh, I do. That's right. I got it off one.
We might want to read over this together and see whether we really understand what he's saying. And then I have examples of towns who have recently established the Historic Preservation Commission and have developed ordinances, and I think they could be very helpful, but I think if we have questions, we need to know what the questions are so that we can get the answers for the questions. Establishment of a local historic preservation ordinance. This could be a town-wide in scope or not, or apply only to local historic districts or individual landmarks. Created under the zoning power, an historic preservation ordinance could apply to the entire town, could enable designation of one or more local historic districts or of a local landmark. Landmark designation power would be applicable for individual buildings, landscapes, would be used in situations where a broader historic district designation would not be appropriate.
So how do we go about deciding if we want A, B, C, or A, B, or C?
I'm sorry?
How do we go about deciding what kind of ordinance we want, whether we want
it all inclusive or one or more local historic districts?
Well,
how do we do that?
Well, that's why we're looking at this, so that we can think about it, and by the time
okay.
we end thinking about it, come up with some ideas.
Weren't there a number of facilities that were named during the comprehensive plan? So
yeah.
we've got
and
a list of these.
I forgot
facilities.
To mention the interesting thing last night.
That's the national register.
That's the national
yeah.
register.
With the whatever his name was, the person that spoke, what was his
Martin or something.
The DOT man.
Oh.
Gave us maps.
Ernie?
I don't know that I even knew his name.
Oh,
and we
engineer.
Have on these maps, you have the historic district located. But according to this map,
they're in here in color code.
I don't think is that the same map I have, Don?
Yes.
I think it is.
I think so, individual at all.
Did you bring yours, the copy that you had in?
I can get a copy.
Okay.
I just wrapped it up and wrapped one up.
Wow, that's beautiful.
It's beautiful, but it's hard to read.
Yep.
Mm. So it doesn't have a code or all the numbers?
I thought I had that here. Not his code necessarily,
those,
but what
yeah.
came out of the comprehensive
yeah.
plan.
And didn't James say, or maybe Chris did too, that we needed to, before we can do really start organizing a local historic district, get a little more punched or create a board from our commission so we'd have a little more.
Well, exactly. That's we're aiming for that.
Okay. Yeah, and I don't really understand exactly how we do that unless they just
well,
name
by
that.
When we get to the way that the ordinances in the other towns have set it up, I think we can get a better idea for ourselves. That's
oh,
why I have that.
Oh, okay.
But I was a little concerned with this because it seems like some of the properties that they have listed that are eligible don't correspond with the names of the ones that we have. So this would just happen yesterday, so I really haven't had time to clarify that or get it clear in my own mind. So I think we'll set that aside and get that. But I also noticed that this goes back to 2011, and I think this is a report from Kirk Mooney, who's now the head man at the Historic Preservation Commission. But I think that there's more recent material available, and so this is dated. But I need to clarify that, so we won't confuse ourselves with that. Let's just read through this, and then we can go to the sample. They're not sample; they're really actual documents from Wiscasset and from Ellsworth. So, you know, the first one. I think it's pretty self-explanatory. You can identify individual buildings. I'm trying to think of one that in this town, and I really can't think of an. Well, it would be the farm.
Mortland?
No, the out on on Mortland, the Mortland farm. That's not in a district. That's
set aside.
Yeah. So that might be an example of that. And then also I found it interesting in reading through the materials that you can identify landscapes. It doesn't have to be a structure, which
yes,
is interesting. So establish a local historic district. The other thing that I need to clarify in my mind is apparently the local district is not necessarily the federal district is not, it can be the same, the boundaries can be the same, but the way it's handled can be different between the federal district and the local district. In other words, the federal authorities don't have too much control over it, but the local people can establish ordinances to control what it is we want to control. So I think we can better understand that as we go along. So then, to establish a local historic district, presuming the downtown might be first in line, there can be several options. You could utilize the same boundaries as the current federal National Register downtown. And I think, you know, we assumed that that would be it, and I think we probably will decide that, but it seems interesting that it could be different.
Well, I think there are a number of sites that are different that we should include, like Sam Houston House. That's not on the federal one.
No, that's correct, but we don't have documentation as of now for that
either. Right.
But it could be if we did, yeah.
If locally we decided that should be mm-hmm. a historic structure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I think there's several that we could go through, like, you know, like we were talking about the one that was going to have the red building on the Sears Point Grading.
Well, you know what? I forgot to put that down here, actually. I should... Let's talk about that a little
okay.
later, because
okay.
I think that is important. That's a good example.
I'm just saying examples, but we probably could designate.
Yeah.
Or at least bring them up for discussion.
But to go on with this for now, you could utilize the same boundaries as the current National Register Downtown Historic District, create a district with smaller, more restricted boundaries, or a larger one. It may also be feasible to designate one or more additional non-contiguous local historic districts, which is what we've been talking about. To manage a local historic district, Searsport would need to also establish a historic district commission. And that's what we're talking about now, how, you know, we believe that we should evolve into that mm-hmm. in some way. Also, for any new district created, additional survey and inventory work would need to be undertaken to establish the legal basis for designation. That's what I say. You can't just say this is historical. You have to have documentation for it.
Well, we have the work that was done by the owners for the historic preservation. The people that came and presented to us on their properties. There is some, we do already have some documentation because mm-hmm. some mm-hmm. of those people did research.
Yeah, title searches and all, whatever the,
mm-hmm.
yeah, historic searches.
Yeah, that's right. Creation of a historic preservation commission. This entity would have a townwide authority to conduct preservation planning activities like additional survey and inventory work to eventually identify all the important properties in Searsport, or assisting the code enforcement officer in managing the certificate of appropriateness process for obtaining a building permit for buildings in local historic districts or locally designated individual landmarks. James was talking about that. There is a, let me see if I have it here. There's a property, and I didn't bring it, that's, if George were here, he could tell us. It's on the left. It's the building that sits back from the road, and it's obviously an old house. I don't know that we have documentation, but it's been empty. It was, I think, a restaurant. But somebody bought the property and is wanting to put some kind of a alcoholic beverage supply place. And his plan was to build some kind of a warehouse in the front of this building, which from the plans would kind of obliterate the building. And the idea would be that you would drive up through this warehouse type building to pick up whatever it is you ordered and then drive out the other side. Is that right, George?
Yes, that was canceled by the owner, or tabled by the owner.
I'm just using it as an example where if we can evolve this.
That was the property.
Old Silkweeds or whatever it was over in the Harbor District.
396 East Main Street.
Yeah, and then they've stopped that, or they're just.
They just
not moving forward right now, okay.
It's not going forward.
And if we had, as part of our ordinance, a, let's see, what are we calling it here? A certificate of appropriateness, then we would be asked to decide whether that structure in front of this old house is appropriate in terms of the rest of our neighborhood. So, you know, the sooner we can get moving on some of these things, the better protection we'll have, I think, as we go down the road.
Mm-hmm.
But as George says, fortunately for now, it's been tabled, but those things are going to pop up. And then the Searsport Historic Preservation Commission could also be constituted to conduct the regulatory work of a historic district commission, which would supervise any local historic districts that your community might designate. In other words, an HP commission could have dual functions in the modes discussed above, planning and regulation. Part of this, of course, would depend upon town staff and volunteer capacity and the public understanding and desire to support preservation planning in Searsport. Such activity in communities with preservation ordinances and commissions, as I mentioned, generally have a stronger, expanding, and more resilient tax base as a result. In the downtown, a local historic district designation is the only means of managing change with the National Registered Listed Buildings, as there is no control for properties with only the federal designation. I didn't know that. I didn't realize that. So theoretically, unless we have ordinances, people who own these designated properties can do anything they want to.
The National Register properties.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So, I think, you know, down the road, we're going to need more help, I think, from Chris to interpret and guide us with some of these things. But in the meantime, I thought that we could look at these documents that other towns, particularly Wiscasset and Ellsworth, have just recently developed.
Hmm.
So, I gave you, or did I? Let me see what I did. No, this was the, I had given you this before. This was a meeting back in November of 2015, just not too long ago, in Wiscasset, who were just, now Wiscasset, you would have thought that they were ahead of things. But apparently they're just at the point of developing this too.
Hmm.
So these are minutes which I got off the internet of their meeting where they discussed this. So Karen, maybe you and Don can share that one. We won't go over that together, but it gives you some idea of what they were doing.
Do you have one?
I have one. She gave it to us in April.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
I may have it too.
And then this is the ordinance that came out of that.
I think I have the ordinance. Let's see what it is. Page 72 of 421.
That's should be a quick.
You know, that's why I asked George to copy it for me, because my old computer would burn up if I tried to copy all of this.
So you've got this too, haven't you?
Yeah, she just passed.
But I think we don't need to go over their preliminary meeting together, but I think that, how would you like to do this? Would you like to read through it and then bring up questions that you have, or shall we read it through together? I'll give you a few minutes to look at it.
Is that page 72 of 421?
Yeah.
And whose ordinance is this?
Wiscasset.
This is Wiscasset.
Wiscasset.
I also have Ellsworth.
Is it similar?
Excuse me?
Is it similar?
Yeah. It you know, they
I'm
go
assuming
at,
they use some kind of template.
Right.
Mm.
And
well,
just reinvent the wheel.
Exactly. Well, that's
right.
Exactly why.
Yeah.
At least it gives you some idea of how to go about it.
I like the purpose and establishment.
Yep.
That feels very familiar.
Yes.
Yeah, very appropriate to us.
See, on this second page, contributing structures, a structure located within a designated historic district and identified as contributing to the historical architectural significance of said district, even though it itself may not be designated. And then certificate of appropriateness.
Ah, contributing, okay. So all of this is part of that one ordinance.
Yep.
Okay. Has it gone through the town meeting?
Oh yeah. It has to be approved by the selectmen first. And I understood that we were going to have a selectman here tonight, but I don't. He's not here.
I mean, I wonder how something like this would be viewed by the town of Searsport at town meeting. Might be tricky.
I think we have to proceed very carefully, very empathetically.
I would suggest we have fewer pages.
Yes.
Suggest what?
Fewer pages.
Fewer
I agree.
Pages.
A smaller.
If we can do it.
Start smaller.
Be more concise, yes.
Yeah.
We already have our signs, you know, sign ordinance, so we don't have to deal with
one,
that one.
Yeah, one thing. The thing is, if you cut back on it, what do you leave out? I mean, they're pretty thorough.
Yeah, but I think talking politically in town.
I know what you're saying, yeah.
Well, it's like the preliminary procedures. The establishment of new historic districts, historic sites, and historic landmarks shall be done by the amendment to section 10.4.4. Mm. And then you go to 10.4.4, designated historic districts, historic sites, and landmarks. This ordinance may be amended only by vote of the governing body at the annual town meeting. Upon adoption and amendment of this ordinance, the following lands, buildings, or structures or areas of the town designated as historic resources and shall be shown on the historic overlay map. So anything that gets decided has to go before the town meeting.
Oh yeah.
So I think it's the job of the Historic Preservation Commission to bring to the attention of the town the concerns that we have about particular buildings. And so you're right, everything has to be documented because we have to have the answers.
And we also have to have the ordinance before we do any of that.
Yeah, but it's pretty
inclusive. But the ordinance also has to be passed by the town.
Yeah.
By the town meeting.
Yeah, the Historic Preservation Commission may make recommendations to the Board of Selectmen concerning the use of incentives for the purpose of promoting and ensuring the preservation of historic resources of the town. So, yeah, we don't make the decisions. We just bring everything to the selectmen, and then they decide to take it to the town meeting. Which sounds appropriate.
I'm not sure about that.
But it just feels like it's anything we do is going to take a lot of time.
A lot, yeah. I mean,
a lot of time.
That puts...
It sounds like a rebirth of the comprehensive plan.
Yeah,
honestly.
Right.
Yeah.
It does.
Yeah,
yeah. But it's got a lot. It sounds like it's got a lot more meat in this than we have.
But this is the reason we can even begin to do this is because we did put that into the comprehensive plan, mm-hmm. and of course that has not been passed by the town yet, but presumably it will be, mm-hmm. and so therefore that gives us the authority to go ahead and plan this. Would you like to look at the other one now?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. This is Ellsworth. And I would appreciate if you would keep these so that we don't have to make
keep
comments every time.
Yeah. On, I don't know what the page is on, 86, where it says administrative procedures. It says, 10611, notice to applicant, property owner, and abutters, before consideration of the certificate of appropriateness, the town shall inform the applicant and property owner of the date, time, and location of meeting at which the application shall be reviewed. Would that be the planning board? Would they be the ones that would hear that and decide about the certificate of appropriateness?
No, we would be the ones that would decide that. That would be our authority.
Okay.
Well, maybe that could be one of their line items when they go through their list of, you know, appropriate things. A one about historic appropriateness when they change the building.
I think that when we have, you know, absorbed as much of this as we can,
yep.
I would like to suggest to James that we again have Chris come and work with us as we work through this. Because most of these towns are bigger towns, and they have attorneys and you know, landscape people, and who have some background and some authority, and which we may or may not have, and yet we feel that we have a responsibility to move ahead with this. So we want to do it in the best way that we can.
Yep, that's fair to everybody.
And you know, Chris keeps emphasizing that it is to our economic vitality that we do this, because towns that have done it are in a much better position to attract business and to have tourists.
And everybody knows where they stand, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And it does share the responsibility for these things amongst the whole town.
Mm-hmm.
But it does seem like we should be able to simplify it and not have however many pages that is, that's a lot to put onto a voting. I think people would just look at that and vote no. I just don't see that as passing. I think I can just see that taking, spending a lot of time and then having it just blocked.
Mm-hmm.
So if we could simplify it and see where we want to zero in on first for a protective kind of an ordinance, then we'd have a better chance of getting that through, and you can always maybe tighten it up.
And it might be that
they're not used to having this kind of something in place, and most people don't want to have a lot of rules.
They figure if they own property, they should be able to do what they want.
Yes,
exactly. So it would be like we're taking away their
right
to manage their own.
So you want to stress that once destroyed, these historic resources cannot be replaced.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why we're here.
Yeah.
And it is, as I keep saying, because I'm quoting other people, is that it does improve the economic vitality.
And I think that would be the other thing you'd say, those two things, yes.
I think that we may. I know James keeps talking or has mentioned several times about a, what is the term? Certificate of
appropriateness.
Yep.
And perhaps we can start with developing an ordinance regarding that.
Yes.
And then as we go on, develop other parts of the final document.
Well, Ellsworth is only 9 pages.
Oh, really? And we really need to read through. We really do need to read through these things and try to absorb it.
Well,
and then see what's helpful for us.
Yeah.
Well, I think maybe to take the scary part out of the town off at town meeting part, voting no right off the bat.
Mm-hmm.
If we stress now that we have to preserve these things that are already there, but only choosing certain ones.
Yeah.
And or in certain areas, if they know that that we're not going to regulate something off the top of our heads, we know which ones are going to be looked at. I think.
And why?
And yeah. Why? I think they would. The fear would be gone. I mean,
I think the other thing that we need to learn about ourselves is, for example, the metal roof on the first block, the house of the name of that block, Karen?
Merrithew? Which one?
Not the one with the metal roof.
On the right, the first.
Yeah.
The first one.
I don't know.
Oh, where the old bank is?
Yeah.
That block.
Is that Knox Brothers block?
No.
No.
What is the name of that block?
The
well, anyway, you know what
yeah.
I mean.
Yes.
They put a metal roof, which is highly inappropriate. It's good. I put a metal roof on my house in Blackberry Lane, but that was appropriate because it was a contemporary house. But I mentioned that to the historic preservation chief at one of the meetings I attended. He said, yes, and that's too bad. When there are other means of having a good roof, it's just a matter of having people know what it is. You don't have to deface. You don't have to change something to make it better. So I think that's the other part of what we have to do, present options, present alternatives.
Mm-hmm. Right. But people aren't going to bristle at being told what to do, even with options.
But I think we ought to bring out our whole program, because we don't want to get a program and then have to go back and amend it.
Right.
We don't want to what?
We ought to have our whole program to bring out and not get one and then go back for an addition to it, because that would be suicide.
Well, of course, that's a different approach from what I just mentioned. I just mentioned that maybe we could do the certificate of appropriateness as one thing, mm-hmm. and then incorporate that into a more comprehensive. So, obviously, there are different ways
mm-hmm.
of doing it. I think the town manager would like to see that certificate of appropriateness soon, because he thought it would be appropriate to use it for that building that I just mentioned, where they want to put the warehouse in front of the historic building.
So that would be something similar to what the planning board uses when they go down through their list. They go down through their list of things
right.
that have that have been accepted or are acceptable. So we would have something like that.
Well, we, you know, it'll be interesting to see how we are able to work with the planning board, because mm-hmm. I think that we are two town committees that have a mutual goal,
mm-hmm.
But the emphasis is not necessarily the same, and probably they would use us for advice, or maybe we might have the authority ourselves. They might do like they did with the signs, give us the opportunity to say whether this is appropriate or not appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
We also have to, I think, work with the districts, and because some of the districts are sort of compromised, I'm told, from, you know, as far as like what's a residential and business, and there are probably some historic houses in business areas
mm-hmm.
that we have to designate.
Mm-hmm. Well,
but I had a thought as I was watching, you know, things change over in on the east side, East Main Street. There's two new buildings going in there. The other one was potentially supposed to go in there. That area is slowly turning into a more business, I wouldn't say industrial, but
it is zoned for that. That's the reason, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but maybe in a district like that, we can use a certificate of appropriateness and indicate that maybe it's not acceptable to always make a business decision.
Mm-hmm. Or the businesses have to be done in a
way that's more appropriate.
That's right, that mm-hmm. goes along with the architecture of the town. And I was coming through town from the south, from Belfast, this morning, and I thought, you know, as you come in this year's board, things look pretty good.
Yep.
You know, our downtown, if we get the downtown spiffed up with some
yep.
sidewalks and lights and things
yep.
like that, that all will look pretty good. And then they get the other side of town, that starts to fall apart a little bit.
Yep. Well, that's where the businesses are.
That's where the,
that's where the port
industry
is.
Yeah.
The industry is there.
Well, where the port is. And I'm not against the port. Trust me,
right.
we
yeah.
need the port.
But I mean, that's what the biggest change is.
Yes.
That's more the working part of the community.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
That's more the
yes
the money part. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Yeah. Taxes are a lot more on the west side than the east side.
Yeah, but it can be still attractive.
Oh,
know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And not, it shouldn't just go to pot just because it's zoned business.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you know, if you drive through states, not that I've done it extensively, but I've observed the times that I've been there. For example, North Carolina, you go down a big highway, and there are turnoffs, but you don't see any of those businesses from the road because there are hills in the front with plantings, with trees above them, so that when you drive in, there is the whole row of businesses, but you don't see it from the road, from the main road.
Hmm.
That's another way of handling those kinds of things.
Oh, yeah, like a buffer.
Kind
mm-hmm.
of camouflage. Yeah.
Yeah, camouflage.
Like berms.
Yeah, it is.
It's there.
There
you
for sound
it.
From the highway, to insulate
yeah.
from sound
mm-hmm.
from the highway
mm-hmm.
to the other side.
Yeah. I like this one for Ellsworth. It kind of talks in my language.
Where,
you know?
Where are you?
Oh, well, I'm on page 5 right now. I haven't gotten any further, but I was reading about the certificate of appropriateness, and it's spelled out much clearer as far as I'm concerned. For me, it's much simpler. Maybe the other one is too. It just felt like I finished reading it and I was still wondering what do we do with that.
It sounded like a lawyer was involved in the Wiscasset one.
Probably. And we probably will have to have somebody check in this one to make sure
yeah,
we don't screw
so
up. But
yeah.
The application process or procedure here is interesting, that written application for a certificate of appropriateness shall be submitted to the Historic Preservation Commission stating location, use, and nature and of the manor or item for which such certificate is sought, application for the appropriateness shall be submitted to the code enforcement officer, who shall transmit such application to the Historic Preservation Commission for action. The commission shall act on the application within 60 days after the submission. Mm-hmm. It shall be returned to the code enforcement officer, who shall then issue or deny permits as appropriate.
Well, that's just the way the signs.
So it's like a check and balance
the
thing.
The
right.
Keeps going, kind of.
Work.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's good. Yes, the code enforcement officer works with the planning board, and they're always sort of checking
right.
in with him
yeah.
for things like that. So.
Yeah.
He attends most of those meetings, it seems.
But he can only do what he has enforcement
rules
for.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Rules for. Codes for.
Codes for. Sure.
Without some kind of a plan, he can't. Do anything.
Well, that's the idea of
that's
the ordinance.
Why we
want
to do this. So,
yeah.
So he's got meat to make decisions with.
I like the opening paragraph of this was tacit one.
I like that too.
It's kind of like a mission statement.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the was tacit one was nice too.
That's what
very
she's talking
similar.
About.
Yeah, they're both.
That's
oh.
What, yeah.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Ellsworth.
Nope,
no,
she said
okay.
the tacit one is the one. It's a good one.
Okay.
I think better than the other one.
Seems a little more inclusive.
And I, you know, Chris was quite impressed with our, you know, driving through our town, and of course he picked out, he just thought that we had a really good place to work with. He was a little upset with where Goodall and Mount Ephraim come together. There's kind of a mishmash there, and he was saying something about having a landmark or establishing some kind of special place as the beginning of the historic district. So I would need to get more clarification about what he was talking about.
They were they were talking about that whole area last night, about that some of it in there is federally owned or controlled, and so there's a problem like putting another lane in for turning or a light or anything like that.
A federal highway?
Well, I didn't really
understand
it.
Jurisdiction,
maybe. More of a jurisdiction.
Yeah. I don't know the feds had anything here.
I didn't either.
I know the state does.
No, yeah, but no, they were talking. You have to talk to James about it.
Mm-hmm.
He seemed to know about it. And
mm-hmm.
so did this state fellow.
Mm-hmm.
Well, aside from taking this home and reading it more thoroughly, how would you like to proceed with, what would you think is the next step?
Good question.
I know what I would like to see.
Well, why don't you tell us?
Yeah, yeah.
We're pretty muddled right
yeah.
now.
I would like to get together with Chris again to help him, to have him help us do some step-by-step things.
Yep.
Because it's a big job.
Hmm. What we should do first or how we should rough draft it, kind of.
And I agree with you. We don't want to in any way usurp private ownership or
mm-hmm.
make people feel that they don't have control over their property. That's not our...
Mm.
Not my goal at all, and I'm sure it's not this committee's.
Yeah, but isn't that going to be some kind of a neat thing to try to do?
Well, I'm sorry.
By virtue of what we're talking about here, we're usurping the owner's rights. So, I mean, you know, there we are. Just by forming this committee, we've pretty much said,
mm-hmm.
we're going to change what you do with your house. I think, am I
right.
wrong? Correct me if I am.
Well,
I
don't think
making suggestions.
I see it as we're, you know, we're going to act as kind of an adjunct to make sure that they don't destroy the historic value of that property. That we're going to know up front what their intent is, and they get to tell us what their plans are, and we get to give them feedback, if this passes, about, well, this would be more in line historically or cost-effective or,
enhance the value.
Yeah, but to me, it's like we want to work hand-in-hand with these people. People don't come in and buy a historic house to destroy it. Some of them come in and do destroy some of the historic value because they don't know any different. This gives us a little bit of leeway to say, come talk to us. Let us help you.
Some of them don't care. I mean, like the fellow, it was, this is a building, I got it cheap, you know.
This is what I want to do. Or if you bring things to their attention, that it is a significant structure, and that to retain these historic structures is an asset to our town, both not only historically and culturally, but economically. Sometimes people don't really know that, or don't think about that, or not aware of that.
Well, then Chris could do us a big...
So I think education is going to go along with this.
Chris could do us a big favor and teach us how to talk about that.
Yes.
You know, help us, give us a list of the advantages that joining this group is going to be, because otherwise we need to know what we can do for them. I worked with the Boy Scouts once and got into it in the district here. And it's just a short story. But it was really bad. Nobody liked the district commissioner, and I was the district commissioner.
No.
So what I did was I went and I got a whole, I went up to the scout office and I got a whole bunch of books and things that I could take to the meetings. And you know, within a year, I was a nice guy. I just kept taking things and doing things for them. Oh, if you got a problem, I can help you at that. And it really worked for me.
Yeah,
we don't want to be tyrants. We want to be adjuncts.
So we've got to be able to come forward with We're trying to help you, and here's the proof that we are.
Trying to help.
We need to word this like we're helping.
Well, we're going to get the backlash. This is, well, why don't we be part of a snob community? You know, that's not what I want. But it's going to behoove them.
Well, they won't move to West Cassett or Ellsworth either.
That's right. But it wasn't when I went to that meeting in Augusta a couple months ago.
Which was the Historic Preservation State Historic Meeting, annual meeting of the Historic Preservation Committee.
Yes, that's exactly what it was. And they had different groups who had, they showcased different projects they had been working on. And each one of them, the important thing that came across, besides patience and persistence, was having the community on your side, get as much public support, positive public support, was absolutely crucial to getting their projects done, to getting, you know, donations, whether it's donations or getting leeways or things like that. It was, so you're absolutely right. Like I think we have to be successful, work on
that. We could find out what their problems are, and we could help them with them. That would be a real...
Help them with the problems of the individual.
Yeah, what problems are you having, you know? I don't know how you could come up with something analogous to what I had, but there must be something that we could help them with.
Well, the community has to want this, to have pride in their community and see the economic, you know, benefits.
Mm-hmm. Economics is a big one.
It's a big one because they've had several economic development leaders, and whether they've been volunteer or paid or whatever, and they've been really hogtied. I mean, they haven't been very successful.
No, I don't think we've seen anything.
Yeah, they can't seem to make any progress, and I don't really say if it's because of public opinion or what exactly. Does anyone else chime in on that?
Well, I think Searswood has a long history of not wanting ordinances of any kind.
Yes, I think that's a
or
neat
even
thing.
Being
yeah.
having districts of any kind. You know, I mean, I can remember as a, you know. young adult
going
to a town meeting or something, and these long, you know, discussions which turned into almost arguments and you're against me or you're for me kind of things, with many of the really, I mean, our prominent citizens, the landowners in Searsport, I mean, there was a lot of ill will that went along with that. And as soon as you stopped talking about it, everybody went back to normal and it was fine. But nobody ever got anywhere with it.
Maybe so, our homework could be to think on this.
Yeah.
What can we as a committee or commission, whatever we're going to be, I'd rather be a commission, truthfully.
Seems to have more
I like
authority.
The sound of that.
Yeah.
You know, what can we as a group, what can we help you with? What, you know, if we can think in our own world, what could a commission like us do to help us? And if we had a bag full of things that we could do to help people, I think we could turn the public opinion around a little bit, because I think it's going to be quite negative.
Well, yeah, you have to look at what their vision is for the town.
Mm-hmm.
And if they want to have they always look back to Belfast, you know, how that's come around. But they made some big changes, and they had to swallow make some tough decisions.
Well, they got down pretty low before they started climbing up.
That's right. And we don't want to get that low.
Mm, no.
But...
Well, let me make this suggestion then. Take these materials home and peruse them and continue to question them and write your questions and your thoughts. And in the meantime, I need to clarify some things about the different interpretations of historic districts between the federal and the local.
Mm-hmm.
And I will find out from James whether we can have some more time with Chris Close and begin to think about how to organize what it is we want to do.
I don't think I'd be fair to Chris if I didn't read these before I saw him.
Right. I'm sorry?
I don't think I'd be fair to Chris if I saw him, tried to discuss anything with him, until I read these.
Oh, right.
I think I really need to take a look at these.
Well, I found them helpful because I think they do express what we want to do, and it's a way of going ahead and doing it. So
I think it is important, though, to think about selling it before you even start, to decide what it is we want to do. And
what can we do?
It's a team effort. This is a team effort for this whole village.
Mm.
Yeah. We need to think about that.
It's very important, what people tell me.
Maybe we could get some ideas from, the planning board and the comprehensive planning committee.
I can't hear you.
Oh, okay. You can't? All right. I think if we maybe even had some kind of invited, say, the comprehensive planning committee to one of our meetings to discuss this, and another time the planning board to our meeting to discuss this, because they've all been through this fire.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And maybe we could come up with some kind of ideas of what to expect, and maybe they might have some thoughts on what to do.
Well, they're having those meetings in different parts of town.
Comprehensive plan.
Are they comprehensive plan meetings, or what their vision of the...
I think they are, yes.
Have they happened? I mean, has anybody attended those?
They had one in North Searsport. I think it was pretty poorly attended. It was on a Saturday night, which I couldn't understand. But
you know what we can do, though? I think we can look at these purposes and write them down, and not these necessarily, but have these help us think about what our purpose would be to do what it is we're trying to do.
We have a beautifully historic, famous town.
Yeah. We have it's a wonderful place. You don't want to
and most other towns
of it, right,
that are trying to do the same thing don't have nearly as much to work with. They have the ocean right there and the tourists on
we don't want to lose our uniqueness.
Yeah.
That's right.
Lose our what?
Uniqueness.
Oh, certainly.
You know, there's only one Searsport in the world, and we're different than everybody else. And that's what the Main Street Revitalization Committee is doing, is we don't want to become Rockland or even Belfast. We want to be Searsport. We want to be unique in our own, you know, our own character and our own flavor of the town, to offer something a little bit different that we just
you know, we're a working community, but we have families and we have older people and we have industry.
A history.
And, yeah, and it's like we can work this all together.
Yep.
We can have it all.
Yep. We need
we're
to
be careful and yeah.
Yes, we need to write it up so that everybody is on the same page.
Yeah.
I don't think that's impossible, but it
well,
does
I don't
take
know if
it does take skill.
On the same
well,
page,
I, you know, I mean,
yeah.
It's a democracy. I mean,
yeah.
What the most yeah. The the best for the most.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And George printed, you know, I could give this to you for you to read at home also, because this is the same kind of thing for Lewiston. So
okay.
Just another, why don't we do
yeah,
that?
Sure. Thank you.
Do you have enough copies?
I think so.
Because I can get one.
We're missing one. Don, do you feel like you want a copy or we should
no,
get
I'm
another
right.
copy?
You don't need that one?
No.
I can get another one, you know, so.
Okay.
Okay, well, I'll take one.
Yeah. I've grown 3 inches.
Yeah, one thing that occurred to me
on one arm.
Well, there, Marie, you've taken care of me reading newspapers.
You're right. Forget about that.
But what did you notice in the Wisconsin one? They have this thing about how many people the board should have
yes.
alternate people. Like,
we've got all these people rushing to be on
yeah,
there.
Yes, I know.
Standing in line, right?
Yeah, yeah. To get on the phone.
How are we going to turn them down?
Yeah. I know, really.
Turn them down easily.
Yeah.
Gently.
But
yes,
something like this with some meat in it will get people
yep.
who want to be part of something.
Maybe
and
who has
have
some power.
Some authority. Yeah.
Fresh
so.
Power. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
and
I've
the
got
other thing, which is way down the road, is once we implement these things, what's going to happen if they don't do it? Is there
yeah.
going to be any penalty or?
Is there going to be any history left?
No. I'm talking about like if we say someone can't put a metal roof on, they said, you know, we're going to do it
oh,
anyway.
Yeah, I can. Well, it would the same thing that would happen to anybody who defies an ordinance. But see, that's where the ordinance comes in.
Yeah. What is that? What happens?
You well, one of the things here
sometimes.
Says you get a $100 fine
right.
so we have
for
to
violation equal. Or a $25 fine for a violation. I don't remember which one I was reading, but.
That was in, okay.
Was it Wisconsin? I just read both of them, so I don't know.
Yeah, probably Wisconsin.
Oh, it was Ellsworth on page 8.
Oh, isn't that
okay.
nice to have somebody in
thank you, George.
Friends in high places, that's
I know,
great.
He just kind of pops in his head.
Yeah.
Like a jack-in-the-box kind of thing.
But the penalties might be as much of a sticking point as the rules.
Well, that'll be a discussion that we need to have with appropriate people.
That's right. That's right. I know it there. Because it's silly if we don't have any penalties.
You know,
well, this is interesting. I didn't finish reading it. Can I just read
okay,
this real quick? This is
a
violation, yeah. Shall be punished, anybody who violates the ordinance,
yeah.
shall be punished by a fine of not more than $100 and not less than $25.
Oh, wow.
But each day that the violation continues shall be deemed a separate offense.
Offense, so
that will add up pretty quickly.
$100 a day would add up quite
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Heftily.
Seven
yeah.
a week, yeah.
They probably put that right on their tax bill.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I wonder if there was one in Wisconsin. Did you read one in Wisconsin, Mary?
I haven't.
Look at
I haven't read the end of it. No.
Okay.
Well, let's see if there is
well,
one here.
Wisconsin being Wisconsin is probably $500 a day.
Violations. So we deemed violation of those applicants.
No, I was surprised that Wisconsin is just just starting this also.
Right. It is shocking because it's
such with everything that's happened there that
yeah.
I'm having a
well, then, like I say, they're just plain old lucky that it's they've had
yep.
a nice.
Yep, they don't have the fines and penalties set forth in 30A MRSA, whatever that means.
That's a state.
Okay, so they.
The statute, yes.
Okay, so they put theirs according to what the state violation would be.
Maine state.
Yeah.
I do want to have a little discussion though about this. Do you each have one of those, one of
mm-hmm.
these, don't you?
Yes.
It's from to David Gardner from
mm-hmm.
the DOT from Kirk Mooney.
I don't
yeah.
have one. I think. When did you get that?
Today.
No, I don't have that.
Hmm.
Did you get one?
from the state of Maine at the top, and it says David Gardner, Maine Department of Transportation, from Kirk Mooney.
No, didn't get one. Do you have any more?
Okay, here's one.
Well, I can take that and copy it.
Okay.
I'll make copies.
This is
Does everybody else have a copy?
I don't know.
I don't have any more. We can make another copy. But this was distributed last night to the,
Yeah, I know that.
To the committee that met.
Yes, I think you have it.
In response, this is dated, which I think is, the date is significant, November 2011. In response to your recent request, I have reviewed the information to initiate consultation on the above reference undertaking, whatever that means. Apparently, they wanted to know what, they wanted to identify historic properties, but, so the commission agrees with the DOT's conclusion that the following properties in the area of potential effect are currently registered listed on the National Register. And we know these: Searsport Historic District, Penobscot Marine Historic District, East Main Street, Captain McGilvery, Captain J.P. Nichols, Captain McGilvery, and James Pendleton. Okay. The following properties in the APE, whatever that is, have previously been determined eligible for listing. House 152 East Main Street.
That's my mother's house.
Now, what house is
that? That's my mom's house.
Which?
My mother's house.
That's your mother's house.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me make a note of that. So we won't call it your mother's house. We'll call it the Murphy house.
For now, until July 8th.
So I didn't know that. Did you know that, Karen? Were you aware of it?
No.
That was happening back in 2011?
No. I did not know that.
So these are things I want to clarify. How come we didn't know that is my question.
M. Porter House, 190.
Do you think it might have been possible that your mother initiated that?
2011. She could have. I think she would have told me.
All right, the J. Barr House, 200 East Main. Where is that? It's supposed to be on
same side of the street because it's even numbered. M. Porter House. M. Porter.
And the J. Barr House, 200 East Main. And the N. Porter House, 190 East Main. And the W. Nichols, 167 East Main.
Well, but then none of the Colquitt House, the Lincoln Colquitt House, you know, Darcy's isn't on there. And our house isn't on there.
Well, this is why I'm going to call Kirk Mooney and ask him to clarify this, because I don't know why any of these are here or not here.
They're not here, right.
And I don't even know. I have to go up and see where they're located. I can't even tell you where they're located.
Mm-hmm.
Radcliffe House, I never heard these names.
No.
140 East Main Street.
That's Douglas Clark, 140 East Main.
Yeah.
That's Dr. Clark's house.
Dr.
Clark, isn't that his name? The
yeah.
blue house?
Kent Clark, right in front of us.
Yeah.
Well, it's not blue now.
In front of where?
Right across from Navy Street.
Oh, yeah.
And that was a Nichols house.
Oh, a doctor lives there, yeah.
Kent Clark.
Kent Clark.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's 140 East Main.
It's the old Nichols house, right in front of us. When you turn up our lane,
mm-hmm. What other address did you have?
167 East Main.
Main, and then on the other side of our lane is that cape. It's the sister.
That's Bain's.
Oh, what
yeah.
belongs to Bain Pollard?
Bain Pollard.
Which one?
167 W. Nichols House.
W. Nichols, really? Never heard that called that.
All right. Well, while you have that book there, George,
yeah.
190 East Main.
Isn't that the one? Is that the one that?
It's the Stone House. Right across from the
yard. Oh, okay, next to the
right across from the yacht on.
Yeah.
Well, what's his name, the lawyer?
Yeah.
Fethi.
Aaron just bought that.
Yeah, Fethi.
Oh, okay.
It's at the Porter House?
No.
No, that's the Nichols House.
That was 167.
Oh, well, you said it was Bain Pollock's.
Well, that's who owned it. That's who owned it.
Oh, he just sold it. Now it's Aaron Fethi.
Now it's Aaron Fethi.
Right.
Okay, and how about 190 East Main?
Daniel McLaughlin.
Oh, yeah.
190 is what?
Daniel.
Across from Silkweeds. McLaughlin.
Oh, that's the old courthouse.
I know the Porters.
That was
Mabel and
the Collins
House.
The Collins House.
Yeah,
it was the Collins House. Okay. Yeah.
Yep.
Porter
that,
was the,
that can't. Oh, okay.
McLaughlin
yeah.
is spelled MCLAUG.
HL. It's a funny. Spell.
No, it's MCGLAUFLIN.
It's kind of a different way of spelling it.
Okay.
MCGLAUFLIN.
Okay, and then 200 East Main.
That's Charles Evans.
Oh, yep, that's they used to have the restaurant there. Rum Line.
So that's
oh,
the
okay.
the Rum Line.
Oh, is that the
which
rum
is for
line?
Sale, sure. Yeah. Okay. That's what
that's
I was thinking that must
also.
Be.
And 152 is actually
so
Chris,
I
want to
know what is the significance of these.
Huh?
The 152 is actually listed under Chris Karen and Tim Murphy.
Yeah, but what yeah. what is it what was the name? It just says house.
Yeah, it's mom's.
I know, but did it have a family name that went with it?
The Murphy House for 16
before that,
years.
It's an old house.
Yeah. Oh, well, Pendleton built
a
Pendleton,
Pendleton house.
So a Pendleton lived there.
Okay.
Yep.
So, Karen, are you saying that you did not know that this had been determined eligible for listing in the register?
No, nope, so, I didn't know that.
So I'm interested in you know who
yeah.
who did this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we'll have to find, okay, and then we also agree that the following properties appear to be individually eligible for listing. 80 West Main, where is that? Is that...
that might be the NAMI house.
Yeah, is that NAMI?
It probably
no,
is.
No, I think it's
he's
further
on
up.
The side of the
road. Oh, no, it would be the next one. It would be probably Summers.
They should be odd.
Yeah.
In
no.
number.
Oh, because it goes...
Goes from the
way.
Center of town
yeah.
out.
All right,
the
so 80 West Main Street.
All right, give me a chance.
Yeah,
it might be Josh's old house.
No.
No?
It's on the other side of the street.
What I'll be looking for.
And it's early.
80.
I mean, well, maybe it isn't. I don't know.
Well,
80 would be on
West
Josh's
starts
side.
At Mill Pond.
No.
So.
I don't think so.
Should be. According to the numbering system, you start in the center of town and you go out.
Oh, I thought you
and
said.
On the right, and on the right is odd, on the left is even.
Yeah.
That's pretty traditional.
Oh.
I think it is in here. I think.
Oh, I thought it going out the other way. It was
80 West Main.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Teresa.
Oh.
Zach Jakokiski
yeah. oh, sure.
or something.
Okay. How do you spell that?
That's Z-A-J-O-N. C-Z-K-O-S-K-I.
Okay.
Yeah.
So which, do we know where that house is?
Yeah, it's the, well, when I was a kid, it was the White House. It's the one right across from Rita Huddleston, almost.
Okay.
It goes down in, it's green. You go down in the driveway, and there's a house and a separate garage.
Mm. Yep.
Do you know what I mean?
For
yeah, it's right
sake.
Along
just there. Before you get to Savage Road.
Yep. yep.
It's like two houses before.
Yeah,
that
exactly
house
right. Two houses before Savage.
Yep, okay.
And the one across from Kendra and Bruce, to Grover's, that house is really old.
Yes, it is.
Oh,
that
yeah.
one's the one
yep.
Mrs. Heath repaired.
That's right.
Totally
yeah.
restored.
All right, how about 172 East Main, George?
It would be up
that
a
says
little
just
bit
a barn.
From the Fethi house. So that's either the Yardon barn or what other barns are up there. You were bird
barn.
Mm-hmm.
Well, is that Mary's barn?
No, because Aaron Fethke.
Well, that comes before you.
Yeah, it'd be after Mom.
Yeah.
Going to the Stockton. I think I'd be born.
I can't visualize.
It's above. It's between Aaron Fethke's house and
the old Collins house.
Okay, that's a yard arm.
Oh, okay.
The yard arm?
Yeah.
Is a barn?
Yeah, there is a barn.
Yep, off to the other side.
Yeah, right up the driveway. Isn't
yeah.
It? Karen?
Okay. Yep.
I wonder why the barn is eligible for the house. Mm-hmm.
Well, it's very, and you go to the pages after that, he says why he disallowed some properties.
Well, on the next page, based on the architectural survey and staff knowledge about Searsport Village, I don't know what APE is, contains a large National Register eligible historic district that encompasses the three existing districts. So we're talking about enlarging the existing districts as well as the number of properties that the Department of Transportation identified as individually eligible for listing in the register. In our opinion, this area meets the definition of a district as set forth in the National Register, which states that a district possesses a significant concentration, linkage, or continuity of sites, buildings, structures, or objects united historically or aesthetically by plan or physical development. Architecturally, the district contains a variety of architectural styles, ranging from the federal period through post-World War II. It includes residential, commercial, civic, and religious, and is eligible under National Register criteria A, C, and possibly B, whatever they are. This district tentatively extends on the north side of Route 1 from survey map to survey map. However, further research and field survey needs to be undertaken to confirm the precise boundary of this district, particularly along the south side of Route 1, as it may extend into the residential areas to the south. In addition, the period and precise areas of significance. We need to find out the significance of this.
Hmm.
What does this mean?
Does that map show shit any way on it?
Are you done with the addresses?
Let me see. What does it
say?
It
doesn't say what they are. Well, it said individual.
Yeah. There's
list
a bunch
property.
Of addresses farther down.
Eligible.
No, he goes on. The B. Simpson House and Barn, 156 East Main. Even
which I think is the Mary House, Treasures and Trash.
The what?
The Treasure and Trash. Because there's Mom's house, then there's an open lot which belongs to Mary, and then there's their house and barn.
What is in the Mary who?
That's the last
Jeff
name.
Jeff Mary.
Mary.
Treasure and Trash Barn.
M-A-R-Y?
No,
M-E-R-R-Y. Yeah, right across from Hamilton Marine.
I know where you're talking about. I don't get the name.
M-E-R-R-Y. Mary.
That's who owns it now.
Well, there's also the Primrose Farm. There's a big barn there. And
yeah, but
that's further on.
That's
way
out. You're right, Karen. That's who
it is. That the one?
Yes,
yeah.
Mary.
Okay.
Is that Kim?
Jeffrey.
Jeff Mary. Yeah.
Okay.
And then 171 Main Street. Isn't that already on in our historic district?
That's William and Carol Pestana. Pestana.
Oh, yeah, that big
one.
That's next to...
Homeport.
Yeah.
Above
yeah.
North?
Could you spell that again, George? It's Paz.
No, that's not much help.
Pestana.
Estann, is that what you said?
No. P is in Paul, E is in Esther, S is in Sam, T is in Tom, A is in Ann, N is in Nancy, A is in Ann.
I got T-A, I didn't get what you said after that.
N-A.
N-A.
Hmm.
And that was the, is that the 171 East Main Street?
Yeah, that's right next to Aaron's house, isn't it? Karen?
Oh, I'm sorry?
Isn't that next to Aaron's?
171 would have to be, oh, that would be the old Amos Nichols house.
That's what that says, A. Nichols.
And they added a summer porch. I mean, they had a porch on it, and then they put glass on it.
And then it destroyed
when I was a little girl, I remember they did that.
I love that house.
Yeah, that's a very old
house. All right, then 182 East Main.
That's Burgefields. Burgefields?
Burgefield. Bergfeld.
Bergfeld, whatever.
Yeah, Bergfeld.
Sorry.
Yep.
And 64 West Main.
I know where his bicycle stop is, place is, but I don't know.
It's the blue house up above it. You go up the driveway, it's up behind. Yep.
And then 64 West Main. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that would be 64 West Main.
64. Katie was, so 64. Is that, that might be Josh's house. Or the Richardson house?
No, I think that's okay. 60. And there was never any William Nichols at that one. That was built in 1910, so it's not not that one. I think that's 60, though, so. I think it's 60.
And then the one we identified so was be, 80. That was
right.
Teresa.
So it's got to be right along there.
Yeah. 64. Is there a house? Mrs. Sand, the one that made pizza for coffee hour.
That would be before. It's Saturnino.
That's before
yours. But that's before. That's before that house. So I'm not quite sure.
And then there's the
you got 64 West Main Street?
Well, I'm trying to find it.
I would think that would be, like 58 or something.
No, that's Phyllis Gall.
That can't. Oh. That's not right.
Well, that's.
That is definitely not right.
That's it. That's what the town's billing for. 64.
Remember, they renumbered.
Well, huh?
They renumbered.
Well, that Phyllis Gall's house, my grandfather built in 1910. It's had three owners.
Huh.
It's not possible to have the other.
Well, that's who's getting the tax bill for 64.
I thought it was 60. It was around there.
Well,
that's weird.
Mary, who were the three owners?
Your Bertram Richardson, John Richardson, and Phyllis Gall.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I have to get this understand. I don't understand this.
And there seems to be a lot of other houses.
For its association with William G. Nichols and for its architectural significance.
Oh, and then there's more. There's more memo. The next one is February 6, 2012. And that one, are these properties that the road would impinge on? Is that why they're asking these to be documented?
No idea.
Because this is to the Department of Transportation.
Yeah, that sounds weird.
Hmm. On the next page, Mary, under 64 West Main Street, eligible under criteria B and C for its association with Captain William G. Nichols and for its architectural significance. That can't be. Captain William Nichols. One of the ones that we did on the cemetery tour.
Hmm. Captain William G. Nichols.
Well, why do you say it couldn't be? You say it's not.
Well, she's saying it wasn't built until 1910, and
it
Captain William Nichols was way back in the 18th.
Yeah, the 19th century.
Mid to late 19th.
It wasn't built until 1910.
Yeah.
Could it be East Main? 64 East Main?
Well, look up 64 East Main.
There is not 64 East Main.
Oh, okay.
Isn't that funny? I mean, that's peculiar.
Yeah. I wish they had down here why it was, well, I guess they do. they question whether it's significant.
Well, but on the next page, they have more, as you just said.
Oh, right here, on the last page. Yeah. West Main Street, 64 West Main. The commission concludes, based on the architectural characteristics of this property, that the house dates to the early 20th century rather than the late 19th century. So,
right.
There you go.
Consequently, the house would not be associated. Yeah. Okay.
And would not be eligible under criteria.
Right.
So they discounted it right there. And 182, the property does not seem to have sufficient integrity to convey its agricultural history, wherever 182 was. Where's 182?
Birchfield.
Okay, so that one's off.
But why were they interested? Why was the Department of Transportation interested in
these why
properties
were they?
Is what I'm interested
in February of 2012.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to make a phone call.
Whenever they're going to have to operate on some land that they need permission to be on or rights to be on,
I imagine it's something
that. They do an intensive research at the Registry of Deeds.
To make sure they're not.
They really bungled that one.
Well, yeah, they're not perfect, but no, they do a lot of research. So they have a lot of records.
They try. I was impressed with that guy that was leading, that was here from the Department of Transportation. He was trying to do his job.
Mm-hmm. And that may have, now that I look at this, the Department of Transportation, Mom's house, the bank is very close to it, and
it's
always getting trucks running to it and whatnot, that they may have been looking at widening the turnabout there,
mm-hmm.
which would have meant they had to go into Mom's property.
Sure.
And so that may have been why that was on there.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
But they were doing some research so that they didn't damage the integrity of the
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense because there's a lot of buildings that are just as old, not older.
But when it says 2011, it's like, that's...
Well, when they take an easement, they like to take the easement from the right people.
Yeah.
It's helpful.
But I think this is interesting and significant for our records because it gives us more information.
Mm-hmm.
They've done this research.
Oh, yeah. All over the state.
Mm-hmm.
A lot. They have people on their staff that do nothing but that.
Hmm.
And they're good at it.
Hmm.
All right, so shall we schedule a meeting
for July?
For July, I think I suggested July 21st, which is the third Thursday. Third Thursday. And in tonight's paper, I noted on this first section, when you get a chance to read it, the three-building section of High Street, known as Phoenix Row Center, was built in 1829 and rebuilt sometime after 1887 when it was destroyed in a fire. Zoning laws adopted a century later rendered the three buildings behind the connected brick facade too small to separate. So the discussion in the article is, how can they sell that whole block, or can they separate those three shops into separate buildings?
Is that in Belfast?
So it's Belfast, and this is in today's paper, so it'd be interesting. Do you all get this paper?
I just got it. I haven't read it yet. So that's on the second page.
Do you want me to read it? The ground floor of Phoenix Row was reborn this spring as a pair of new businesses filled vacant storefronts and a landmark restaurant came under new ownership. That was Darby's. The 19th century block, composed of three buildings behind a single facade, also served as a catalyst for a change in the city's zoning ordinances. Rockland-based Side Country Sports opened its second store, and then Camden Bagel Cafe is advertising a mid-June opening, and Darby's Restaurant, the popular bistro. Archie Barnes, who owns Phoenix Row, said he tried unsuccessfully to sell the three buildings as a single property. Recently, he took it off the market and approached the city about a common-sense subdivision that would allow him to sell each of the buildings separately. Subdividing the property would create at least one building that did not meet the city's 2,000 square foot minimum lot size and requirement for at least 20 feet of street frontage. Barnes said he is in talks with a buyer for one of the three buildings. Eventually, he said he could probably sell the other two. City planner Marshall estimated that 20 of the 99 properties in the downtown commercial district are similarly at odds with the code. Zoning in Belfast is relatively new. Marshall said most of the code took shape in 1985, more than a century after the construction of Phoenix Row. On Marshall's recommendation, the City Council waved through a first reading of an amendment to square old buildings with newer rules. Pending a final vote, owners of downtown properties built before July 16, 1985 would be able to apply for contract rezoning and be treated on a case-by-case review. That would create an opportunity for something like Phoenix Row, even though they can't meet the technical requirements of the code, to meet the spirit of the code and allow a division. A public hearing on this and two other minor changes to zoning ordinances will be held June 21st. Hmm. So, those are the things
that happen. That's a historic.
Yeah, that would be very interesting to. Well, that will be very interesting to watch.
What's the date for the next meeting?
21st.
21st. Okay.
Well, thank you. We've had an
interesting
discussion, haven't we?
Yeah.
Mm. Let's see where we go from here.